Hi, this is David from Minute Earth. In 1985, we found out that the world as we knew it was ending. The ozone layer, the natural atmospheric layer that shields the Earth from the sun's super damaging UV rays, had, in certain spots, lost 40% of its thickness in the previous 10 years. If the trend continued, the shield would become so compromised that in a matter of decades, UV rays would destroy the world's food supply and cause blindness and skin cancer epidemics around the world. But here we are, 4 decades later. We've got lots of problems, but an ozone-instigated dystopia ain't one. And that's because back in 1985, we followed a surprisingly simple formula that helped us stave off the impending ozopocalypse. Step 1. Understand the problem. What was destroying ozone, the gas that makes up the ozone layer? Man-made molecules called CFCs, which are found in everything from hairsprays to refrigerators, were a prime suspect. And scientists found that when those molecules reach ice-cold stratospheric clouds and get hit by ultraviolet radiation from the sun, they release chlorine atoms that go on a turbocharged ozone-destroying rampage, where each chlorine atom can destroy 100,000 ozone molecules. Step 2. Science your way to a plan. It soon became obvious. The CFCs needed to go. Because hundreds of industries relied heavily on CFC molecules as propellants and refrigerants, scientists worked overtime to create replacement molecules that could do the same things CFCs could do, but without accompanying ozone-destroying side effects. Step 3. Get the political powers that be to agree. By 1987, just 2 years after the ozone hole was discovered, many of the world's most powerful nations signed a treaty called the Montreal Protocol to stop producing CFCs, which cut off the supply of CFCs going into products, and therefore into the air. Step 4. Take advantage of a little luck. Lots of different things had to break our way to get the Montreal Protocol signed. For example, then US President Ronald Reagan, one of the biggest potential roadblocks due to his anti-regulation stance, happened to be a skin cancer survivor, and his surprisingly enthusiastic support was key to getting the treaty ratified. Since then, the concentration of CFCs in the atmosphere has been reduced by 98%, and we are on track to have our ozone shield back to its thick former glory by 2075. We've used the same four-step formula to successfully tackle other global crises too, like in eradicating smallpox. First, understanding. Virologists figured out that unlike diseases like bubonic plague and yellow fever that incubated in other animals, smallpox was a uniquely Homo sapien disease that relied exclusively on human-to-human spread. Second, a plan. If we could completely stop the virus's spread in humans, we could kill it off for good. So public health officials created a strategy to send elite teams of vaccine specialists to inoculate people whenever and wherever the disease flared up. Third, political agreement. In 1966, the World Health Organization got all countries on board for the intensified eradication program to put the plan into action. Fourth, we took advantage of a lucky break. Smallpox survivors share distinct scars that are super recognizable, so it was actually pretty easy to spot disease flare-ups and rapidly vaccinate everyone nearby. By 1979, there were 0 people on Earth infected with smallpox. It was eradicated, which has already saved an estimated 200 million lives. But just because there is a basic formula for staving off global disaster doesn't mean that actually following it has been easy. And our current and future crises, from climate change and a pandemic to nuclear war and disloyal AI, are only going to be harder to solve. Despite the fact that we have more advanced science on our side, we also have more divisive politics that make global cooperation even more fraught. But we've successfully saved ourselves from destructive molecules and pathogens in the past. And if we follow the formula, we should be able to do it again. And again, and again, and again. This video was sponsored by the Future of Life Institute to celebrate recipients of the Future of Life Award. This award is given annually to individuals who have steered the course of history away from disaster without having received much public recognition at the time. The 2020 award went to Victor Stanoff and Bill Fagey for their contributions to the eradication of smallpox. And this year's award goes to Joe Farman, Susan Solomon, and Steven Anderson for their roles in saving the ozone layer.